recently I finished a paper that's entitled Online Platforms, Agency, and Competition Law, Mind the Gap. And essentially, this is a paper in which I try to explain that there is, as currently conceived in EU competition like Leeds and in other competition laws model on the basis of the EU model, there is essentially a platform gap. And I have 10 minutes to speak, and the paper has exceeded 90 pages. So I'm going to try to give you really the bottom line, and hopefully if you find it interesting, we can go through the details in questions. So we have heard several times this morning that the platforms that we're talking about are essentially matchmakers. And the idea of matchmaking really goes to the essence of what platforms do. And this is a really great phrase to call them as matchmakers, because it immediately sort of tells you what the essence of the business model is. What it doesn't say is that it doesn't say anything about the legal nature of such an entity that is in the business of matchmaking. So matchmakers have, of course, existed in various forms for a lot longer than online platforms have. And in this paper, I argue that actually business model and the legal nature of the business model that we see in online platforms has also existed for many, many decades more than online platforms. And that model is that of agency. An agency is a legal phrase because it has legal consequences and legal implications. In commercial law in particular, lawyers, you know, are used to dealing with agency a lot more than, for example, competition law. And the argument I made in this paper is that transaction platforms, so platforms that intermediate the transaction between a supplier, let's say ebook suppliers, and consumers, let's say ebook readers, are essentially agents. And the implications of this for competition law is that, as I said, in the EU there is potentially a platform gap. And why is there a platform gap? Well, the platform gap arises as a result of the so-called single economic entity doctrine we have in the EU. So in the EU, it's an undertaking that engages in an infringement of competition law, and an undertaking for the purposes of EU competition law is not defined in the same way as a company or an undertaking in other areas of law. And over time, a doctrine has developed in the EU, which is essentially finding agreements, restrictions of competition between entities, which may be undertakings in themselves, that restrict competition, not to be part of the scope of competition law, to the extent it applies to anti-competitive agreements. I'll break that down a little bit so that the individual components are clear. So if an agent, a genuine agent, enters into a contract with its principal, and in that contract there are restrictions of competition, then the part of the EU Competition Law Article 101, which prohibits anti-competitive agreements, simply does not apply to that agreement concerning those restrictions of competition, because the agent and the principal are deemed to be part of the single economic entity. And this doctrine has been applied in the context of agents, which look like traditional agents. It's been applied in the context of, for example, a fuel supplier and petrol stations, and so on. And this is similar to the US inter-enterprise conflict law. And this goes back to the point Yaron was making about vertical restraints. If we think that the platform is in a vertical relationship to a supplier, so the platform is essentially a distribution channel for that supplier, and if the platform is an agent, then vertical restraints between that platform and the supplier would actually come out of the scope of competition law. So this paper is about scope of competition law. Does competition law apply in the first place, rather than whether any given restraint is anti-competitive or not? And of course, this would also have implications in relation to, for example, private damages actions, because those actions also require figuring out who supplies what to whom, in which way, in a given platform and supply relationship. And we've seen that the Supreme Court has come up with, in the US, has come up with its own interpretation of that relationship in Apple and Pepper. So why is this relevant? So the question is, what are platforms legally for European competition law purposes? And the next question is, of course, what are the implications of that, and should that platform commission, but decided on the fact that these agents were not agents. So why would I think they're agents, I suppose, is one of the first questions. Well, part of the reason is, at first glance, they seem to be essentially doing what an agent does in facilitating a transaction between two parties, two potential parties to a contract. And many of them actually self-proclaim to be agents. So the question I had that sort of made me go on and do further research into this was this question: what are platforms leading? And what I have done is that I have looked at several areas of law, so common law, commercial law, tax law, employment law, because I realize that actually in tax law as well, whether an entity is supplying a service or is only intermediating the supply of a service between two other parties is critical for deciding, for example, who pays tax or what. So looking at these other areas of law and looking at the standard contracts of six different platforms, I've come to the conclusion that on balance, these platforms are essentially agents. So which platforms have I looked at? I looked at Amazon Marketplace, Apple App Store, WeWork, Booking.com, eBay, and Airbnb. And remarkably, actually, even though you might think these are completely different companies, doing completely different things in completely different sectors, actually, when you look at their standard terms and conditions, they are very, very similar. And the business model just seems almost identical. So in a nutshell, taking sort of the pertinent factors from all of these different areas of law and looking at the standard terms and contracts and the business models beyond the standard contract as well, why would they be agents? Well, let's think about what they do. These platforms, at no point in a contract, ever own the product that they are facilitating the sale of. They never keep stock of anything, and I'm not talking about Amazon, fulfillment by Amazon, I'm just looking at the simple Amazon marketplace situation. They don't normally contribute to the costs of delivering that product or the actual provision of that product to the customer. They don't set the price, which is quite important, except to some degree in the case of Uber, but there are different reasons for why Uber might have to do that. Now, platforms do not buy to resell the product either when you look at how the relation between suppliers and the platforms are created. And therefore, they cannot be retailers either, which is, of course, not what the US Supreme Court said in Apple. Quite importantly, the contract is concluded between the actual customer and the supplier, and the platform is not a party to any contract between the customer and the supplier at any point. Now, in the paper, I say that actually platforms, online platforms, are more agents than estate agents, as we know them. Because estate agents introduce parties, but they don't conclude the contract, and the contract doesn't get concluded by the party's introduction via the estate agent. Well, we see that in most platforms, actually the contract itself also gets concluded through that facilitation of the meeting between the customer and the supplier. And this is quite typical of agency in other areas as well. They're remunerated by commission, and they will only take commission if a successful contract is concluded, so they're remunerated for services. And most importantly, they don't seem to take any of the financial or commercial risks that would result from that contract that's concluded between the supplier and the customer. Now in the paper, and I'll finish with that one, I also argue that if this is the situation, that these vertical restraints are essentially not just treated more leniently than horizontal restraints in the competition law, but they're completely immune because of the agency exception. And we have to question whether that immunity is justified. And I identify one situation, at least, this is the situation I focus on in the paper, where that immunity is not justified. And that was referenced indirectly by Damien in the earlier panel today, where essentially the platform is also a competitor to the supplier. And we can trace that back to agency, the nature of the agency business being fiduciary, the interest of an agent and a principal having to be aligned and so on. But it also makes sense, I think, for competition law purposes that if a platform is listening, it's normally an agent, but if that platform is also competing with the suppliers for whom it's supposed to be facilitating transactions on the same platform, then that immunity should at least in that case not apply. And I think the danger we have at the moment with case law going in all sorts of different directions. sort of encourages some business models perhaps over others, it's also not dealing with the issues that arise from the actual business model directly that goes around the business value and around the market.
Thanks, Pınar.